Well, I'm glad you're here today. It's been a great morning of worship of the Lord today. I don't know if you know, our drummer's name is Mario, and I watch him as he plays. He really gets into it, and the whole platform was moving, and one day he's going to move right off the stage. I know it. He just goes crazy. So, hey, that's right. We're in a series right now on 6 weeks talking about when Jesus comes back. We're talking about the events that are going to be totally associated with the second coming of Jesus Christ. I'm really excited about this series. Last week we talked about what is the first event, and it's called the rapture of the church, when Christ comes for true believers and he takes us out of here. And the Bible talks a great deal about this. The biggest passage is in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and we camped in on that, but there are many other passages we brought in as we talked about this incredible event that is coming. And there is nothing to be fulfilled, in my understanding, between now and that point, so it could happen any day, and we look with anticipation of Christ's return. Now, when we talk about the events related to the second coming, we're used to hearing terms like the Great Tribulation and the Antichrist and the Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse and the Battle of Armageddon and that sort of thing. But I wonder if you've ever heard of the Battle of Gog and Magog. Well, the truth is, probably very few in this room have, but that is what I'm going to talk to you about today. And very few people, it seems, really understands this particular prophecy that Ezekiel gave to us 2,600 years ago, 600 years before the birth of Jesus Christ. However, there is a section of the book of Ezekiel that is all about the second coming of Christ. There's a part that talks about the first coming of Christ, and those prophecies were literally and physically fulfilled in the first coming, and they will be in the second coming as well. And in this section, beginning in chapter 37 and going all the way to 48, the end of the book, Ezekiel identifies three particular events that will take place. In chapter 37, it is the story of the dry bones, the valley of dry bones, and how Israel will be reborn and will come from many nations, and the Spirit of God will breathe in them and bring them back. And that literally happened in 1948 in the rebirth of the nation of Israel. I wasn't here at that time, but we as a generation had the opportunity to see an absolute miracle of prophecy take place before our very eyes. The rebirth of Hebrew, the language of Hebrew that had been lost and all that sort of thing was one of the most amazing miracles in our day and age. Then, beginning in chapter 40 and going through the end of the book, it is all talking about a new temple, which those of who are involved in prophecy, especially take a premillennial view, see as the third temple that will be built. The temple that will be built in the last day, in the last days. And that is identified in those chapters. Sandwiched in between those two things is this story in chapter 38 and 39, this prophecy that Ezekiel tells us will happen at the end of the age, at the last days. He identifies this to be a end of the days kind of prophecy. And all of these actually are as well. It is that section, chapter 38 and 39, that I want to talk to you about today. Because in truth, all of these nations that he identifies, he gets very specific, very particular about the nations that are involved. All of these nations that he identifies are now, as we look in our generation, are now in alliance. And the weaponry in place and the motivation for the invasion is already in place as well. And I want us to take a look at this amazing prophecy that Ezekiel gave to us. Now, I will tell you this, that all that we're about to look at has never happened in human history. There have been times in which different battles and different ones of these nations had been in league with each other, but no time in which all of them were a part of some invasion force, and not any time in which all of them invaded Israel. This is an event that is still to come, and I hope we have it happen in our lifetime, though we will not see it, in my estimation. So let's take a look. And there's four questions that I want to ask and answer so that we will understand this prophecy in chapters 38 and 39 of Ezekiel. The first question is who? Who is this? Who is involved in this big invasion of Israel? Beginning in Ezekiel 38, verse 1. The word of the Lord came to me, son of man, set your face against Gog of the land of Magog, the chief prince of Meshech and Tubal, prophesy against him. This great battle that Ezekiel is describing is called the War of Gog and Magog. The War of Gog and Magog. Now, these two terms, Gog and Magog, are two terms connected with modern-day Russia. And how do we know that? Well, the name Magog is first listed in the Bible in Genesis chapter 10, verse 2. Magog is the grandson of Noah. And after the flood, one of the sons of Noah, Japheth, migrated north and obviously then had his family there, and Magog was his son. Meshech and Tubal are ancient tribal names of descendants of Magog. And we know from world history and confirmed by archaeology that Magog's descendants lived in the same geographic area that we now call Russia. And in fact, it is interesting that the Wall of China was built for the purpose of keeping Russia from invading China. And in Arabic, the name for the Wall of China in Arabic is Al-Magog. They directly, in their language, connected Magog with Russia. In the first century, Josephus, who was a Jewish historian that lived in that century, wrote a direct connection between the Scythian people as being the people who are the descendants of Magog, the Scythian people. He wrote this in his writings and historical writings in the first century. Well, the Scythian people were the people that occupied the very region that is now called Russia. Russians are descendant of the Scythian people. All of that together is conclusive, quite honestly, that the people that live in the area of Russia are the people that are the direct descendants of this guy named Magog. The word Gog is also referred in prophecy as the leader of this invasion force of Russia who leads the invasion. So let's stop for just a moment and take a look at a map and see how it comes together in the map. This is the red, little red spot there is Israel. It's tiny, isn't it? It's only the size of New Jersey. And in fact, a whole big section of Israel is occupied by Palestinians and is not actually in control of by Israel, but Israel is this small, the tiny little spot on the map. Russia is to the north, that's the second map, and in brown, and you'll see it. And this is the first nation that is identified as part of the invasion force, Magog. But there are other nations that are involved. So let's see what else he says in the prophecy, beginning in verse 5, Ezekiel chapter 38. Persia, Cush, and Put will be with them, all the shields and helmets, and Gomer with all its troops, and Beth Togarma from the far north with its troops, and the many nations with you. Get ready, be prepared, you and all the hordes gathered around you, and take the command of them. I'm really grateful that Ezekiel identified each one of these nations, or most of them, by using the descendants of Noah as the identifier. If he would have used the names of the nations at the time that he was writing, well, we might not totally understand what areas he's talking about. But he uses the descendants of Noah so that it gives every generation the opportunity to go back and know exactly the locations that he's identifying. For instance, Cush and Put comprise all the regions of Sudan and Libya in North Africa. Take a look at the next map. You'll see where they're located over here on the left in brown. And then Beth Togarma is eastern Turkey. Everybody knows that Gomer was from Mayberry, so we can identify that immediately. Only some people in the room will actually get that. But the best scholarship we have today suggests that Gomer actually would make up the rest of the region we know as Turkey. And so with both of them together, it is the country of Turkey, and that's the next slide you'll see. So now we're painting in another country. And then he says that Persia will also be involved, and that is modern day Iran and Iraq. And so let's look at the next map, and there you go. Now we've got the outline of all the ones that he lists, and when I saw that, I thought, well, yeah, but there's no country that is next to the border of Israel. So, I mean, why would he leave out Syria? Surely they'd be involved in this. Why would he leave out Saudi Arabia and Jordan and Egypt and Lebanon? And then I went back and I read, and the many nations with you. He is only giving us identifiers of some of the other nations, and then he just says, and there are other nations that are involved, and some of the other nations really gives us the hint of the rest. These are predominantly Muslim nations. So it makes sense that if Russia and these Muslim nations would attack Israel, the other Muslim nations nearby would probably be a part of that. And so this is the inclusion of, and the many nations with you, and I have filled in those blanks. He is not identifying every nation. He's identifying some of the nations to give you the idea of the others. So here is what the prophecy of Ezekiel chapter 38 and 39 is painting the picture for us. These nations all coming together, led by Russia, and coming to take over and destroy Israel. Now the question is then, we talked about who, when. It is obvious in the details of these two chapters that this happens in the end times. He uses these words, in the last days, in the latter years, in the latter days. And in fact, I think four times in this chapter, he identifies when this happens. It happens in a period of time that we would call today the time of the second coming of Jesus Christ. But the exact time, he doesn't tell us in the structure of what happens in the second coming. The exact timing of this battle is purely speculation, and I'm letting you know that. Many theologians who take a premillennial view of the second coming of Christ, like I take, either have it just before the rapture of the church that we talked about last week, or just after, and I take it to be just after. I take it to be just after because I believe that the rapture of the church is actually what causes this event to take place. And what I want to do is kind of give you the rationale and reason for this. First of all, the timing is definitely last days. It is definitely by all the passages on either side of these two chapters, it is obvious it fits the chronology between the rebirth of Israel and the building of the third temple. It is in this period of time. But second of all, the question that came to my mind as I was studying the passage is, where is the United States? Now, obviously, Ezekiel didn't know anything about the United States, but in his explanation, he doesn't identify any countries coming to the aid of Israel. If there were any other countries, surely as he gave this so detailed explanation, he would have said, and there were other countries that came to the... But he doesn't mention any other countries. And so I wonder, where in the world is the United States? I mean, obviously, if anybody attacked Israel, the United States would come to Israel's defense. So why is there no mention of us? Well, it's possible that by the time this happens, that the politics in the country will have changed and there will be no interest in being in alignment with Israel. But somehow I really struggle with that. Even if there were someone that emerged that didn't have much of a love for Israel, there's just too many voices in this country. So many evangelical Christians that want the government to support Israel. So many Jewish people that live here. And I've got to believe that with all of the voices and all of the people in Congress that would be voicing that and that sort of thing, that we would stay in alignment in our support of Israel. So I find it hard to believe that we would abandon Israel. Then I thought, well, maybe it's what's happening at that time is just a whole bunch of natural disasters in the U.S., turmoil in the country, and maybe we're being attacked by terrorists or whatever, and we're involved in some war, and we say, hey, we've got our hands full, we can't help you. But I think this is really what it is. I believe this happens right after the rapture of the church. Now, this is just my opinion, and I'm just being honest about that, but I think this is when it happens. And if it is that it happens at that time, what kind of an impact would the rapture have to Muslim countries that are around? Well, every Muslim country has Christians in those countries who are true Christ followers, and they'll be gone, but it won't make much difference in any of these countries, especially militarily. How much difference would it make in Russia? Well, there are Christians that live in Russia, but there would not be much impact at all when it came to Russia's military force. Wouldn't make much impact at all. But in the United States, when the rapture takes place and God takes us out, and we looked at those verses, not just 1 Thessalonians 4, but the other passages in the New Testament that deal with this issue, when that moment happens, it'd be my hope and desire that tens of millions of believers would be raptured out, even maybe 100 million believers would be raptured out. And I think about all the people in Congress and all the people in government across this country that are born again Christ followers, and boom, they're gone. And generals and people in different branches and different levels of leadership in the military, and the soldiers, how many soldiers who are Christ followers, and all of a sudden all gone. And I think about the confusion of losing 100 million people perhaps in this country that are Christ followers, and boom, they're gone. And you think about what would happen in this country. I believe we'd be downgraded militarily. We would be downgraded in leadership. We would be in I won't be here. They will be in mass confusion throughout this country. What would happen with all these people gone, all these babies gone, all these Christ followers gone, all these people gone, is that this country would be in such turmoil and such struggle that this is a prime time. This is the right moment for Russia and these Muslim countries. We haven't been touched. We have no problem to say, look, the United States has been crippled. They've been seriously downgraded, no longer a superpower. Let's go after Israel now. Nobody will stop us. You see what I'm saying? This is just my opinion. I happen to think it's right, but it's just my opinion. But I think it makes logical sense, and I believe that this is the moment. And I'll explain a little bit more in a moment what I connect with that. There's a third question I want to answer, and that is why? Why in the world would these countries go after Israel anyway? Just a little dot on the map? Why go after them? Russia has always been anti-Israel, pro-Muslim. It was the Soviet Union in 1967 that pushed Syria and Egypt into the Six-Day War with Israel. It was the Soviet Union who was behind the Yom Kippur War of 1973. In 1982, Israel discovered a large supply of war materials in southern Lebanon, and everything, every bullet, everything was stamped the USSR. It had all been provided by Russia. Russia has sold several components, at least, to the nuclear plan of Israel, of Iraq, rather. I'm sorry, of Iran. And is the supplier of armament to Arab nations. Russia is an obvious connector to all of this. So why is Russia and Muslim countries so interested in destroying Israel? Well, the first obvious answer is a hatred of the Jewish people. An abject, absolute hatred of the Jewish people. But you understand that in Islam's history, it's not always been that way. In fact, in the 8th, 9th, 10th centuries, there was a peaceful coexistence between Muslims and Jews, all of them living in Jerusalem under Muslim control, and there was not an issue. What has emerged is more of from the 20th century. The rebirth of Israel as a nation, of taking over this area that had been Palestinian, the Israel coming back as a nation has been the fuse that has lit this hatred and the desire to destroy Israel. And because we have sided with Israel, it has been what has motivated the hatred toward the United States as well. Second, Russia and Muslim nations can take back the land and its resources. It might be the size of New Jersey, but it is a very wealthy, it is very resource-heavy area of the world. And in fact, Ezekiel himself, in his prophecy, said the motivation will be plunder. And notice what he says in Ezekiel 38, verse 12. I will capture vast amounts of plunder. I will take away many slaves, for the people are rich with cattle now. And notice this phrase. They think the whole world revolves around them. This was written 2,600 years ago. There's never been a time the whole world revolved around Israel until now. And in a very real way, the whole world revolves around Israel. Here's why. Because of Israel taking that land back, because of the Muslim response, and the resulting spilling out of the Muslim extremist and killing and blowing up and bombing everywhere, the whole world's view is on the Middle East. Everybody looks to the Middle East. And everyone's trying to build up defenses to protect themselves from all of these radicals and all that sort of thing. In a sense, the whole world revolves around Israel for the first time ever. Third of all, Muslims can once again gain control over Jerusalem. It's the third holiest site of Islam. Mecca, Medina, and Jerusalem. Jerusalem is the place where supposedly Muhammad ascended to heaven from the Temple Mount. But there's a bigger reason. It is God who is bringing them. It is God who's actually moving in the hearts and bringing them to this place at this time. We'll see that in just a couple of moments in a passage of Scripture we're going to look at. Israel is now defenseless. The United States has been crippled. Ezekiel chapter 38, verse 11 and 12, you will say. Now, part of the chapter is speaking to this guy, this Gog, this leader of the invasion force. And part of the chapter is sort of hearing the thoughts of this guy. You will say, I will invade a land of unwalled villages. I will attack a peaceful and unsuspecting people, all of them living without walls, without gates, without bars. I will plunder and loot and turn my hand against the resettled ruins. The resettled ruins and the people gathered from the nations. When Israel came back after the Babylonian conquest, they came from one nation. They came from Persia. But when Israel came back in 1948, they came to resettle ruins from nations all over the world. This is a perfect description of what happened in 1948. A perfect description of what has been laid out in chapter 37 of the Valley of Dry Bones and coming back and life being rebreathed into it. The resettled ruins, the people gathered from other nations, rich in livestock and goods, living at the center of the land. So why does God bring them back? What is God's motivation with this? I believe God will use this moment to judge Russia and her allies for the 60 million innocent people the communists imprisoned and killed in Russia over the last 80 years. Researchers claim that 15 million Christians and 5 million Jews have died in the concentration camps of Russia since 1917. Did you know that? Richard Dawkins wrote a book called The God Delusion. McGrath wrote the book, The Dawkins Delusion. It's the better book. In Dawkins' book, The God Delusion, he makes this statement. And by the way, the book was written really to influence college students. He wrote in his book that there needs to be an end of all religion. If you end all religions, you'll end all wars. Because every single war is because of religion. So if you can get rid of religion, you will have peace on earth. When I read that, I was just absolutely stunned that anybody would say what he said. Because the truth is, communism has as its worldview atheism. It isn't motivated by religion. It is motivated by anti-religion. It is an atheistic worldview. And there have been no more murdering, not anything like the murdering and the killing and the wars that have been created like communism has created. Tens of millions of people were murdered, slaughtered, imprisoned, killed, because of an atheistic worldview. And it makes more sense because the truth is an atheistic worldview sees no real inherent value in any life. We're just accidents anyway. So whoever is in charge can make the decisions of millions of people being slaughtered and who cares? There's no real God to answer to. The truth is, Dawkins is so full of it. The real truth is, so many times more people have been killed because of an atheistic worldview than any religious worldview that is out there today. There'll not be peace on earth, goodwill toward men. The truth is, God is the one behind the scenes bringing all of this together for a reason. Let me get more to that in a moment. The last question is what? Who, when, why, and now what? What happens in the end result of this invasion? Chapter 38 is about setting up the invasion, about explaining what's going to happen. Chapter 39 is explaining what happens when they come. Ezekiel chapter 39, verse 1, "Son of man, prophesy against Gog and say, this is what the sovereign Lord says, I am against you, O Gog, chief prince of Meshech and Tubal. I will turn you around and I will drag you along. I will bring you from the far north and send you against the mountains of Israel." God is saying, I'm the one actually who is bringing you to this moment. "Then," verse 3, "I will strike your bow from your left hand, and I will make your arrows drop from your right hand, and on the mountains of Israel you will fall, you and all your troops and the nations with you, and I will give you as food to all kinds of carrion birds and to the wild animals. You will fall in the open field, for I have spoken, declares the sovereign Lord." The word sovereign means the God who is totally in charge. And God says, I have set this moment for a reason. I will bring you here. When you go through the 39th chapter of Ezekiel, what you discover is that the sum total of all of the explanations is that over 80% of the invading armies will be wiped out. How will God do that? Here are all these nations. It looks like Israel has no hope. It will feel it has no hope. And all of a sudden, when they all arrive, 80% wiped out. How? Well, the first thing God will use is a well-timed earthquake. Ezekiel 38, verse 19, "In my zeal and fiery wrath, I declare that at that time there will be a great earthquake in the land of Israel." Second, God will create confusion and infighting within the invasion force. Verse 21, "I will summon a sword against Gog on all my mountains, declares the sovereign Lord." Whose mountains are these? It's His. "And every man's sword will be against his brother." They'll begin to actually fight each other. God will bring disease and natural disasters. Verse 22, "I will execute judgment upon him with plague and bloodshed. I will pour down torrents of rain, hailstones, and burning sulfur on him and all of his troops and on the many nations with him." Here's what God is saying. I will make sure that Israel is rescued, and it will be obvious that God is the one that did it. Not the United States, not Israel's own ability itself, but God will rescue. Here is why I believe, another reason I believe that it happens right after the rapture of the church. What has happened in that rapture of the church is that the United States has been downgraded in its power. And now Russia and all of its strength in the Muslim nations, 80% of their armies have been wiped out. When there is a vacuum, somebody always fills the vacuum. And this is the moment in which I believe the Antichrist rises to power. Let me tell you what the hint is about this issue. When you keep going in chapter 39, you come to, and I should have put the verse number down, and I'm sorry I didn't. The armies are destroyed, and the Bible says that the inhabitants of Israel gather the wood of the armament and burn it for 7 years. If he would have said 2, if he had said 10 or 15, well, it wouldn't have connected to anything. But when he said 7, it makes total sense, because when the tribulation period begins, it's for 7 years. And he says right after this wipeout takes place, for the next 7 years, Israel will be using the armament it collects as fuel. This is my opinion. I believe what happens is the rapture of the church. Then, with the absence of the United States power, the battle comes, ensues, the invasion happens. The wipeout of all of these nations allows a void for this guy that the Bible says will emerge, that the Bible calls the Antichrist. Next week, we're going to be talking about the 7 years of tribulation. And the week after that, we're going to be talking about this guy named, the Bible identifies as the Antichrist. This guy takes this moment and signs a peace covenant with Israel. Daniel chapter 9 explains that the tribulation, the 7 years of tribulation, doesn't begin at the rapture. It begins with one moment in time in which the Antichrist signs a peace covenant with Israel. And in that peace covenant with Israel, there is the okay to build a temple, the third temple, on the Temple Mount. Because Daniel talks about this very thing in Daniel chapter 9, about this temple being in existence. This is the moment that I believe that the Antichrist, in this void, this gap, this vacuum, rises to power, signs the peace covenant with Israel to build this temple. Israel would build the temple now, but there happens to be something in the way called the Dome of the Rock. And the truth is, Israel doesn't want to get rid of the Dome of the Rock because the Dome of the Rock is what keeps these other Muslim countries from bombing Jerusalem. They are afraid they might hit their third most holy site. It is, in essence, a protector. But at the end of this battle that Ezekiel lines out for us, these armies, Muslim armies, are gone. And this is the moment. No one can protest. They take care of that Dome of the Rock. They remove it. And they build that third temple that is very important to these 7 years of tribulation that is described in the Bible. The truth is, I have been to what is called the Temple Institute in Israel, and this is the institute that has been designed to help manufacture, get everything ready for the third temple, and it's all done, and they take you through all of that. It is all ready. All they're waiting for is the opportunity. There is a growing hunger and preparation to build Israel's third temple, and I believe that it will be built as a result of this battle, this war, and then that peace covenant with the Antichrist. It is God that is in charge of all of this, and it is God that is moving. He's the one that brought the world into existence, and He's the one that will take it out. And He has told us what He will do with all of the events that will lead up to this moment. And here's what I want to ask. All of you who are Christ followers, I want to ask of you three things. One, that you pray regularly for the peace of Jerusalem, like Psalm 122 calls us to do. And second of all, that we live a life that is ready for Christ's return. And third of all, that God would be able to use you, just like the illustration that Bruce gave earlier, to share our faith with kindness and love for those who do not know Christ, that they might come to know Jesus Christ as Savior. We can't argue anybody into the kingdom of heaven, but we can sure love them and lead them into that relationship with Christ. There are some in this room that have never given your heart to Christ. You've never invited Him into your life. Maybe you've been religious, but religion doesn't save anybody. And maybe this morning is the opportunity that God has brought you to this place at this moment to make the decision, I give my heart to Jesus Christ. The Bible says all of us are sinners. None of us deserve heaven. None of us. But Christ came to do what we couldn't do. He came, lived the perfect life, died on the cross to pay the penalty for our sin, rose again from the grave, and offers us the gift of eternal life. And this morning, would you give your heart to Christ? Would you receive this gift of salvation from Him? Let's pray together. Father, move in hearts today. Men and women, boys and girls, to come and give their heart to Christ, to receive Jesus as their Savior, to turn their heart to You. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.